So I think we can start this morning session, which is the last day of this conference, with Claire Voisin, and the title is there, From Analysis Situs to the Theory of Periods.
Thank you. So I thank the organizers for inviting me to speak here. It's not obvious because I work in algebraic geometry, and one may have the feeling that the work of Poincaré is not particularly in algebraic geometry. In fact, this is quite not true. I will speak about the theory of periods. So the title of the talk may give the feeling that the theory of periods started after Poincaré, which is completely wrong. And in fact, what I want to emphasize is that the fact that the theory of periods existed on small dimensional varieties, namely Riemann surfaces, much before Poincaré. And then the work of Poincaré in algebraic geometry was absolutely crucial to make the theory of periods possible. Alors donc je continue, c'est bon là. Okay, so I try to speak louder. What I wanted to say is that first of all, Poincaré himself contributed to the theory of periods on Riemann surfaces, simply by his work on the famous upper half plane, which was directly whose motivation was a study of periods of elliptic curves. But more importantly, his contribution comes from his work in algebraic topology, which was very, very important for making possible the study of periods in general in higher dimension. So what is the classical theory of periods? So this was initiated by Riemann and also by Abel and Jacobi. So that concerns the study of the maybe not exactly the topology, but certain integrals which are constructed from the algebraic curve. So the simplest examples are what we call hyperelliptic Riemann surfaces. They have a very simple models from algebraic geometry. They are represented as double-sheeted covers of the Riemann sphere given by this equation, u to the square equal to f of z, where f is a polynomial in z. I see the Riemann sphere as the compactification of the complex plane. So in the complex plane, I have this coordinate z. Of course, I have to add the infinite point to make it into a sphere. And so this Riemann surface has a genus d minus 1. And of course, this double-shotted cover has it has a ramification at the point where f vanishes. And here, of course, you have only two square roots of f of pi. And then when you have this model, it's very easy to understand the topology or a basis for the H1 homology of your Riemann surface. And so what you do is that you consider two points on your Riemann sphere, and then you consider a pass from between these two points. And now you have your two sheeted cover, which is above. And it looks like this. Of course, I assume that I avoid any other ramification point. And of course, now your path, which was not closed before, it becomes a loop, gives you a loop in the Riemann surface. And so this is the first ingredient. And the second ingredient is the introduction of the what we call the holomorphic one-forms, but which are in fact very algebraic because we have this explicit form on the Riemann surface. So here, you may have the feeling that this form has singularities because of the pole F, but in fact, if you compute locally, you see that there are no singularities. So this is an algebraic, a holomorphic form, everywhere defined on sigma, and the periods are the integrals of these holomorphic one-forms on these contours, closed contours, gamma. And of course, there was an enormous amount of work done concerning these period. So, for example, the parameters, of course, it's a F essentially, of course, maybe the choice of P. And there are algebraic parameters, but the periods themselves, they are only holomorphic functions of the parameters. And in fact, they are multivalued, and this follows from the fact that my gamma here, it's not. I made a choice, and well, when I follow the parameters, I may have some monodromy which changes the class of gamma, and the resulting objects there are solutions of the so-called Picard-Fuchs differential equations. There is a monodromy of these equations, etc. So this is one aspect which has been very much studied. And another aspect, which is much more inside algebraic geometry, is the fact that you can see the periods as a determining a complex torus, which is associated to the Riemann surface. This is called the Jacobian of sigma. And of course, it plays a very important role in the study of Riemann surfaces. And what I want to explain now is essentially what are the periods in a higher dimension. So, well, I come back to the very beginning of homology theory. And I think that most of what I will say is due to Poincaré, but I will also explain that from time to time, some extra ingredients were needed to give a very solid and complete theory. So, well, the Poincaré starts with the notion of homology, what we call homologies. Well, essentially, you have here's a picture is in dimension 2, but you work in any dimension. You have a n-dimensional oriented manifold, capital gamma. And it has a boundary, as Poincaré very clearly explains, the boundary has now a canonical orientation as a boundary. And from this data, which is of course very very geometric one, on the right, so this relation that the boundary of capital gamma is the sum of these three terms. And so in my mind, the extraordinary idea is to start from something which is very geometric. Everybody can have the idea of what is a boundary, and to write it as something which is completely algebraic. That is an equality inside a certain abelian group. So the main difficulty is what should be that group. So the idea is to construct a free abelian group on certain letters, and the letters correspond to certain geometric objects. And this free abelian group will be called the group of k chains of x, and here of course k is equal to 1. For this in this picture, and well, a very important problem is what is the right choice for these k chains? If you content yourself working with oriented submanifold of folds of your x, or differentiable maps from oriented manifold with boundary to x, what you get is interesting, but it's not what you want. It does not define homology groups. It's rather a kind of oriented cobordism group. So after a while, this was Poincaré preferred to shift to another theory, which I will explain in a minute, which is a simplicial theory. And now, what is used is the singular homology theory. In that theory, the group of k chains is simply the free abelian group built on the continuous. Well, if your x is a manifold, you can take a differentiable map from the k simplexes to x. So I will explain in a minute what it is. And then a k simplex has a natural boundary in this sense, and by restriction of the map, that gives you a differential boundary map from CK to CK minus 1. It satisfies this fundamental relation that delta composed with itself is a zero, and you define a singular homology group of X with Z coefficients as the kernel of delta, of course, modulo the image of delta, which is coming from CK plus 1. Okay, so why I speak about this singular homology theory and not the simplicial homology theory which was introduced by Poincaré, it's the fact that so the simplicial homology theory, it's very, very nice. It gives, essentially everything that you want, and it has an enormous advantage over the singular homology theory, is that you work with finitely generated groups, and in particular, you have this famous Euler-Poincaré formula which gives you the Euler-Poincaré characteristic just from the data of your finitely generated groups, which you do not have in the singular homology context. But the problem, which has been, I think, realized very late, is the fact that Poincaré introduced his simplicial homology, and he proves that it is independent. So he starts from a triangulation, and he proves that it is independent on taking subdivisions. So it's good, of course, you can refine your triangulation. But after a while, people, he believes that any, if you have two triangulations, then you can refine, have a fine common refinement. And this was disproved very, very late, I think, in the 60s or even 70s, in the differential manifold case. And so, finally, the singular homology theory came to rescue, in fact, the whole theory. And this, this guarantee, this is the only thing that guarantees at the end that your simplicial homology theory does not depend on choice of triangulation. So in any case, what did Poincaré was the following. So the simplex, so the K simplex is just the convex envelope of K plus one points as shown in the picture. And so of course it has a natural orientation because you have chosen this basis. And similarly as before, you can write the boundary of your simplex. So again, so there is a trick with the signs which of course the geometric boundary which is of interest is the face, the boundary as a face, that is, you take into account the face orientation. And now, of course, if you consider the faces that are generated by taking one vector less, but if you consider this ordering, you see that you do not get the right orientation. This is why you have to put this sign minus one to the I. And then, so we have the notion of a simplicial complex. So you give you a certain number of vertices, and inside this set, you choose a set S, which will determine your simplicial complex, which is a subset of the set of parts in V. And the only condition that you ask is that if you have an element in your set S, and if you choose now a subset of V which is contained in A, then it also belongs to your set S. And this is of course the abstract definition, but in fact, when you think about the geometric realization, that makes things much simpler. You put your vertices inside R to the n with n very large, and for each element A in your simplicial complex, you consider it's a subset of the set of vertices, and you consider simply the simplex geometric simplex it generates in R to the n, and you take the union of all these simplices. So, and it's starting from a manifold X. If you have a triangulation, you can make it homeomorphic to the realization of a simplicial complex. And in the simplicial homology, as I said, the group of K chains, so it's much smaller than in the singular homology theory. You just consider, instead of considering any continuous or differentiable map from a simplex to X, you just consider those that you have already from the structure of X as a simplicial complex. That is, just work with the simplices of which are part of your simplicial complex. So, so as before, that gives you a certain complex where you have the face, the boundary map delta, and the homology of this complex is the case homology of the realization of the simplex. So as I mentioned, you need finally the singular homology theory to show that finally it's so if you started from a triangulation of a manifold, that does not depend on the choice of triangulation. Okay, and another well, I said that in many cases the contribution of Poincaré had to be completed or corrected later on. And the Poincaré duality theorem, which is of course essential in topology, it's one example where nothing had to be changed. I think this was exactly stated and proved completely by Poincaré. And the proof is remarkably simple. So instead of homology, you can be interested in cohomology. And in fact, it's maybe homology is more geometric, cohomology is some home or a little more algebraic. So a priori, it's very simple. You just dualize. So you had your chain complex where the boundary map sends ck to ck minus 1. And the cohomology theory, it's just obtained by taking the dual object, which is also a complex, but now the differentials d goes to ck to ck plus 1. It is just the transpose of the boundary map of your chain complex. So you introduce the dual complex. And the cohomology of x with value in z is defined as before. So this is the cohomology of this complex, the kernel of the differential modulo the image of the differential. So d goes so the image of the differential from ck minus 1 to ck. So now there is a trick because we are with z coefficients. So what we are doing is that we had the complex, we consider the dual complex, and then we take its cohomology. And if we were with a coefficient in the field, the answer will be very simple. It's the same as considering the dual of the homology. But because we are in coefficient in z, it's not true. There are very subtleties which are related to torsion, essentially. And so because of this, the homology and cohomology are very useful if you work with the z coefficient. Okay. And what says the Poincaré duality theorem is this. So you consider a compact-oriented connected n-fold, and then there is a natural isomorphism between the homology in degree k of x and its cohomology in degree n minus k. So when I say natural, of course, it depends on the choice of orientation. The sign is changed if you change the orientation of x. So, well, when I say natural isomorphism, I mean, it's a little mysterious, this natural isomorphism. I mean, you see it in some sense well in the proof, but it's not so obvious to construct it. It's much easier to formulate, often it's formulated like this, with Q coefficients. Because in that case, the natural isomorphism, I mean, it is given by the so-called intersection pairing. So that makes it very concrete. But as I said, with Q coefficients, the cohomology is nothing but the dual of homology. So in that case, what we are saying is just that the homology of degree k in Q with Q coefficients and homology of degree n minus k with Q coefficients are dual. And the coupling is just what is intersection pairing, just constructed by intersecting chains, by taking into account the fact that you are working with oriented chains and you have an intersection numbers, taking into account the global orientation of your x. Okay, so. And the proof is remarkably simple, but of course you have to assume that you have triangulation. So that was there was a very nice picture of this in the told by David Gabay. It's you start with your simplicial complex given by triangulation of your manifold, and you construct a dual triangulation. So but the idea would be that if you had something like this. Let's assume that you. So here, I'm cheating a little, but assume that you have the beginning of a triangulation like this. What you will do to construct this dual triangulation or cellulation, the new vertex will correspond to the triangles you have here. So I put one vertex for each triangle, And for any two triangles which meet along a line, I put an edge. Okay. And for the vertex I have at the middle, I put a face. So of course this is the simplest picture. In general, things become more complicated. Because in principle you allow to have more triangles. So what you will get is not exactly a triangulation by going to the dual. But in any case, what you see is that so what happens is that. First of all, you get a new triangulation of your X. So if you do the homology theory with this new triangulation, that will give you, of course, the homology of your X. But the very important point is that if you look at the construction, this triangulation is dual of the first one. And that means that if you consider the simplicial chain complex of the new triangulation, it's in fact isomorphic with a shift of degree to the co-chain complex of the original triangulation, and then of course that gives you exactly what you want, namely this isomorphism by taking. So what is remarkable is it is already at the level of chains that the isomorphism is constructed. Okay. So now I am shifting to all this is very geometric, but it has absolutely nothing to do with algebraic geometry. And now we are going to something which is a little closer, namely differential geometry. And so now I am considering a differentiable manifold. And so you have the notion of differential forms. I will denote by a k of x differential forms of degree k on x, maybe. Large class, maybe the class, the infinite class, to make things simple. And now I have the exterior differential, which is very simple to define. And the definition in Poincaré is really very hard to read, and one does not understand very well what he is doing. But it's just basically a d of f dxi. So here it's a differential form is a combination with the infinite coefficients of these monomials in local coordinates, and the differential of this is just a df wedge this dxi, which I write in this developed form. Okay, and so there is of course this important fact that d composed with itself is zero. This is a symmetry of derivatives, and then you define the Durham cohomology with the R coefficient to be the kernel of the differential map starting from AK of X to the set of of course, exact forms, the image of the differential map, again containing this. Now, of course, the relation between Durham cohomology and singular homology is via, of course, the Stokes formula. That is, you can integrate forms on contours. And then the Durham, the Stokes formula says that if you have an oriented submanifold of dimension k plus 1 with boundary, well, of course, you can, it's not necessary to assume that this is a submanifold. Any differentiable map from gamma to x will do. Then you have the formula that the integral of gamma of d alpha is the sum over the integral over the boundary of gamma of alpha. Well, so all this is written very clearly in Poincaré. But now, let's reformulate things a little more abstract way. What says this formula is that you have an integral map from this space AK of X to the space of k cochains of x with r coefficients. The k cochains are the linear forms on the space of k chains. So to a differential form, you associate the linear map, which it's a gamma associate sum over gamma of alpha. So this is so to alpha, you associate this linear map on the space of chains. And this formula is just saying that this map from AK of X to CK of X with value on R is simply compatible with the differential. And and so the conclusion is that there is an induced map at the level of cohomology, and Durham cohomology on one side and the singular cohomology on the other side. And the Durham theorem says that this induced map at the level of cohomology is an isomorphism. So Etienne Schiss showed me some place in Poincaré analysis situs. Some sentence of Poincaré suggesting that he had really in mind maybe part of this theorem. So what we arrived more or less at the conclusion that he believed, or maybe he had a proof of this, of the fact that this map is surjective, which he phrases saying that homology classes can be distinguished by periods or by integrals. So this is exactly the statement that the surjectivity here. The injectivity, you have to say, if I have a closed form, I assume that its integral is zero over all closed contours, and I have to prove that it is exact. And I don't think he paid any attention to that problem. So I cannot resist, because I think it's a very beautiful part of the history of algebraic topology. I want to explain you a short proof due to Weyl of the Durham theorem, and also because it gives another, as it is obvious from what I said, that combinatorics is very important in algebraic topology. And in the Weyl proof of this theorem, you see also a lot of combinatorics, but slightly different. And this is basically because the combinatorics he uses is what we call the Cech combinatorics. So he starts from the Poincaré lemma, saying that if you are on a contractible differential manifold, then forms, closed forms of a positive degree are exact. And then the proof goes as follows. So now you use the fact that you are on a manifold, so there is a good covering, which means that this is a covering by a contractible open set, and you assume that all the successive intersections of your open set are either contractible or empty. That always exists, that follows easily, for example, from triangulations. And now you have this covering, and you do the following. You have a closed form. Okay, so now you call alpha I the restriction of your alpha to your open set UI. And you apply the Poincaré lemma, and you conclude that there it is a d beta I. Of course, the problem is that the beta I, they won't coincide on the intersection. But now you consider on the intersection UI intersected with a d, which I did not like this, you consider the difference beta I minus beta d. It may be non-zero, but it is closed just by this formula. And so you apply again the Poincaré lemma. It is closed, so it is exact. And so you write it as d gamma ij. And you continue. You apply the Cech differential to this gamma ij. You find something which is maybe non-zero, but it is closed, so you write it that it is exact. And you continue. And the idea is that you pass from your closed K form. And at the end, so where does the process stop? It's very simple. That stops only at a point where you cannot apply anymore the Poincaré lemma, because the forms that you get, they are not of positive degree anymore. And so they must be of degree zero. And in that case, what you get is that now a form of degree zero, which is D closed, it's a constant function. And that means that when you stop, what you got is exactly a Cech cocycle of real numbers. And by this argument, I mean, which is absolutely elementary, and I think that Poincaré will have loved it, you pass from the Durham cohomology of degree K to what we call a Cech cohomology of X with value in with coefficient R and relative to this good cover. And the very nice conclusion of the of the Veil paper is here. What Veil observes that now we have this good covering associated to it. You can construct a natural simplicial complex. The vertices they correspond just to the open sets of your UI. Okay, so you put them formally as vertices, and the simplicial you have to decide which set will be in your simplicial complex, and there are just those sets for which the UI, that is the intersection of I belonging to I of the U small I, is non-empty. And associated to this, of course, you have the realization of this simplicial complex, and what you can prove, what Veil proves, is that this your X, in fact, has the same homotopy tape as the R of S. And so the proof is completed because we have this isomorphism. It's completely obvious from the construction of this simplicial complex that this Cech cohomology is the same as the simplicial cohomology of this R of S. And using this conclusion, you find that this is the same as a cohomology, a singular or simplicial cohomology of your X. Okay, so now I come to the subject of my talk, and so maybe I will skip. I mean, I will go quickly on this slide. You could say, well, now we have Durham theorem, and this is finished. The one who like differential forms, they will use differential form, and the other ones, they will use a singular homology or something like that. This is absolutely not what should be done, because for me, the Poincaré, the Durham theorem, it's the importance lies in the fact that it compares, of course, different cohomology theories with R or C coefficients. But of course, the Durham theory, it does not give you the cohomology with Z or Z over NZ coefficient, which is very important for us and for many people. On the other hand, what do differential forms is that they reflect the particular geometry of your X as a differentiable manifold. So essentially, each time you have some extra structure coming from differential geometry, and I am especially thinking to the case of a complex geometry, then this can be reflected on Durham cohomology. Okay. So for example, in the case of complex manifold, you have the holomorphic forms, and of course, they form a subcomplex called the holomorphic Durham complex of the whole Durham complex. And so the hope is to use finally the two sets of data and to combine them into something interesting. And this is essentially the main idea in the theory of periods. Okay, so I am shifting to the subject, which is a period of, in general, I will consider projective complex manifolds. So there is another ingredient, which is, of course, very important, and which also explains why this Durham theory is so important. This is the Hodge theorem, which says that furthermore you have a Riemannian metric on your manifold X, then you have canonical representatives for Durham cohomology classes, and so associated to this Riemannian structure, you have the Laplacian, which acts on differential forms. The harmonic forms are those which are annihilated by the Laplacian. And we know that if X is compact, the harmonic forms are close, so they have a Durham cohomology class. And the Hodge theorem says that in each Durham cohomology class, there exists a unique harmonic form. Okay. And the use in complex geometry is as follows. So in complex geometry, we have local holomorphic coordinates, so the I. And so we can use them to define the notion of form of type PQ. So they are those which are local holomorphic coordinates, combinations of monomials dZi wedge dZg bar, where cardinality of I is P and cardinality of G is Q. And of course, the coefficients here are complex-valued say infinite functions, for example. And then you have the notion of cohomology class of type PQ. This is just the cohomology class of a closed form of type PQ. So that gives you a complex vector subspace of the cohomology of X with complex coefficients. So it's contained in HP plus Q. Because a form of type PQ is of degree P plus Q. And now a fundamental result, also due to Hodge, says that if X is, so the metric on X is a Keller, so for the thing to X, a projective manifold, so it's a projective algebraic manifold, so it's an algebraic submanifold of a complex projective space, and you can consider as a metric the restriction of the Fubini metric on projective space. So that gives you what we call a Keller matrix. And then what say Hodge is that under this assumption, if you consider a harmonic form on your X, its PQ component, well, any form decomposes canonically as a sum of PQ forms, but when the total form is closed, there is no reason for each individual component to be closed as well. But what says Hodge is that for harmonic forms, the PQ components are harmonic. And so because of that statement, you see that the cohomology of your X is decomposed as the direct sum over all PQ, P plus Q equal to the degree, of the subspaces HPQ. And so that gives you what we call the Hodge filtration on the cohomology of a complex projective manifold. So this is a decreasing filtration. That is, the larger the P is, the smaller the space is. So the FP term of the filtration is the sum of the subspaces HR K minus R with R at least equal to P. So for example, the FK HK is just HK zero. This is, in fact, the space of holomorphic forms of degree k in that case. And a very important theorem, which is due to Griffiths, is that this Hodge filtration varies holomorphically with the complex structure on X. One has to give sense to this. If you deform the complex structure, well, it's something which is complicated to do. You have to deform the almost complex structure, but keeping the so-called Newlander-Nirenberg integrability condition, so it's already a hard task. And when you have done this, you have a problem that you have an infinite dimensional space because the diffeomorphisms of your X act on this. But you have to question the resulting space by the action of diffeomorphisms, and the result gives you basically the what we call the deformation of the complex structure. And it turns out that by rather hard argument, the small deformation of the complex structure, this has the structure of an analytic space, maybe not smooth, but analytic. So it makes sense to speak of a holomorphic map on this space. And one has, of course, also to specify in which sense this map is holomorphic. In fact, the Hodge filtration, it's a filtration on a fixed vector space, because here the X as a topological space, it's a given datum. So this filtration, it varies, but this is inside a fixed complex vector space. Now, these filtrations, they are parameterized by an object which has a complex structure, which is called a flag manifold. And so this is an object from algebraic geometry. It turns out that those filtration coming from Hodge filtration, they do not fill in the whole flag manifold, but only an open set. And this is what we call the period domains. So now there is this holomorphicity theorem is of course very important. This is a generalization of what we have seen at the beginning. But in general, what do the geometric period? So we have this filtration on your space. It depends on the complex structure. And now on this space HK, you also have the integral structure that is which is given by integral cohomology. So what do the period, the generalization of a period in the geometric sense, is simply that you study the positions of this filtration with respect to Z basis of this lattice, which gives you, of course, a complex basis of this space. This is what we call periods. And then you see that we recover exactly these integrals that we had at the beginning, because the holomorphic the forms that I integrated, they were describing, in fact, the role of all the holomorphic one forms on your Riemann surface or projective curve. And this is exactly this space F1, H1 of C, which appears here. Okay. And so now I would like to finish with something which is, a complete mystery, which is instead of geometric periods, I will consider the notion of arithmetic period. So I have of course, maybe that looks a little complicated, but up to now, I didn't use really the fact that my X is algebraic. So I just considered it as a complex manifold, and then I use the fact that there are holomorphic forms, a form of type PQ or things like that. But now I want to use the algebraic geometry. And so for this, we have to pass from the holomorphic category to the algebraic category. And this is what was achieved by Sayre in what we call the Gaga principle. So this is a geometry algebraic and geometry analytic, or maybe the other way. And basically, what does Sayre? So, well, up to now, we have seen cohomology with constant coefficients. But of course, we can do cohomology with other kinds of coefficients. And particularly, for example, we will consider what we call sheaves of algebraic sections of an algebraic vector bundle on an algebraic variety. What does that mean? So you have your algebraic variety, you have Zariski open sets, and you consider a vector bundle which is trivialized on Zariski, small Zariski open set. And the important algebraicity lies in the fact that the transition function from when you pass from one trivialization open set to another one, they are algebraic. Okay? So this is the notion of an algebraic vector bundle. But when you have an algebraic vector bundle, you have its analytic counterpart, which is, that is, you forget about the algebraic data. You say, my Zariski open sets are usual open sets, so I have a vector bundle, which is trivial over certain open sets. And the transition functions, well, they were algebraic, so in particular, they were holomorphic. And the new, so you get somehow a new object that we call F-an. And the important point is that from the point of view of sheaf theory, we do not have the same sheaf, because instead of considering the algebraic section of an algebraic vector bundle for with respect to the Zariski topology, we now consider the sheaf of holomorphic section of a holomorphic vector bundle considered in the usual topology. Of course, there are many more open sets, and there are many more holomorphic sections, and many of them do not extend to algebraic ones. Again. And what says this fantastic theorem of Sayre is that even if you make this big change of category, you do not change the cohomology. When I say cohomology, just think about Cech cohomology. Just use restrictions of sections and to build a Cech complex out of it. And so. So this is somehow incredible, because not only you change the sheaf from algebraic to analytic, but also you change the topology. Here, of course, you have to take Cech cohomology with respect to Zariski open set, open cover. Here, you allow Cech cohomology with respect to an open cover by usual open set. So, and now, still I am on an algebraic variety, and so there is a notion of algebraic Durham cohomology. The fact is that your X is algebraic, so it makes sense to speak of algebraic differential form on X, namely think of your X as contained in Cn, so assume that this is a fine case. In any case, any X will be covered by affine open set. And then the algebraic the differential forms on X, they will be simply the restrictions of algebraic differential forms on Cn, namely those differential forms which have a polynomial coefficient here. And here they are the global algebraic coordinates on C to the n. Okay. So that gives you a set in the space of holomorphic or more generally differential forms on X. And there is a remarkable consequence of a Gaga theorem, which was proved by Groth and Dick in 1966. And it says that if you have an affine variety, affine algebraic variety, so that is a closed algebraic in the C to the N, then you can compute. So this is an analog of the Durham theorem, but in the Durham theorem, you have to put a differential form. And what says Groth and Dick is that, of course, we are working with a cohomology with complex coefficients. Then this can be computed by using only closed algebraic forms on X. Sorry. Here it's because that could be ambiguous. CL means for classical. That means this is really the cohomology of the underlying topological space. Because at some point I use also the Zariski topology. That means this is really this is the same object I started at the beginning. I consider my X as a topological space, and I do it's a singular theory, for example, which is given by the Durham theory. Now the important point is to go from differential to algebraic ones. And there is a version of this for projective varieties. Of course, it is more complicated because we do not have enough global algebraic forms, so we have to introduce a double complex in Cheche Durham, where you introduce algebraic forms on affine open sets. And out of this, you construct a complicated total complex. But still, this gives you a recipe, purely algebraic recipe, to understand this object, which a priori depends on topology, only via algebraic geometry. Which is, okay. And now I should stop, but maybe I take 1 or 2 minutes more, because I wanted to explain what are the arithmetic periods. Now, defined as follows. Suppose now I am in the same situation as before, and suppose your X is defined on a smaller open set. Then, on a smaller field. So a priori, it was only defined over C, but of course, sometimes the equations, usually the equations, they have their coefficient in a smaller subfield. So say, call it K, that may be Q, for example. And then, of course, you can make sense of algebraic differential form with the K coefficients. And out of this, you can construct by applying the previous recipe what we call a K structure on algebraic Durham cohomology. That is, a K structure is the data of a K vector subspace, which has the property that its extension to C gives your complex vector space. And how this is done in the. So there are two examples of this. You consider a cohomology with complex coefficients. There is a Betti Q structure, which comes from the change of coefficient theorem that says that cohomology with complex coefficient is the same as cohomology with rational coefficient tensor C. So that gives you the Betti Q structure. That is, you have the notion of rational cohomology class inside of the set of complex cohomology classes. But as a consequence of Groth and Dick theorem, you see that if X is defined over K, you have another, you have a K structure which comes from algebraic geometry and which comes from the computation of this via algebraic differential form with K coefficients, and that will be what we call a K cohomology class from the Durham point of view. And what is the notion of arithmetic period? Assume, for example, that X is defined over Q. Then you have two Q structures for this cohomology, for this complex vector space, namely the one which is a Betti Q structure and the Durham Q structure, which comes from forms with different with Q coefficients. And the fact is that these two Q structures have absolutely nothing to do, and they are related conjecturally. They are as transcendent as possible, one with respect to the other. I wanted to explain what is the transcendence conjecture of Grothendieck, but basically the idea is that this is only via the study of the presence of algebraic cycles, which explain some defect, maybe in higher self-powers of X, which explain the defect of transcendence of periods. That is, some if some periods happen to be algebraic, that can be explained only by the presence of algebraic cycles and some power of X. So I stop here.
Beautiful lecture from topology to arithmetic. So I suppose there are questions or comments.
The case of transcendence, who doesn't know about algebraic
group? What do you mean by algebraic? That was my next slide. But we know perfectly well the comparison between the Betti Q structure and the Durham Q structure if you consider classes of algebraic cycles. Because essentially, up to a coefficient of 2 pi to the I, these coefficients are necessary. For example, if you do, it's just over. So there is this Cauchy formula. Okay, that's a typical example of a period which is very transcendental. Because here you have this S1, and it comes, it gives you this structure and the homology of C star. C star is an algebraic variety. Topologically, it's just a circle. This is a generator of the homology. And here you have exactly a form with Q coefficients. So the Q structure on the Durham side is given here, and the Q structure on the Durham side, on the Betti side, is given here. And the period is 2 i pi, so you have this. So this 2 i pi is necessary. But it turns out that for classes of algebraic cycles, essentially, only powers of 2 i pi will appear. So, for example, if you consider homogeneous varieties, they are only algebraic cycle class. So the comparison in that case is just very easy. The comparison between the two Q structures, it is given by this coefficient of 2 pi to the K if I work with H to K. And if I have to compare the homology classes of cycles of codimension K. So, but otherwise, I think the transcendence conjecture, it's widely open.
Yes, what question was if, like, general conjecture related to that in the case of, say, complex story, we have this algebraic variety, just in complex story, so it's acted by product of the star, if the kind of like Chenil conjecture is of the same type of nature and transcendence of the Grothendieck conjecture, if they're related or not?
I think people like more in arithmetic or number theory Waldschmidt or Daniel Bertrand, this is exactly what they are doing. Well, I think that the transcendence, Grothendieck transcendence conjecture is a kind of geometric interpretative attempt to interpret geometrically some transcendence result, which indeed you are right, the natural context was exactly this one.
And I think the general conjecture would follow from the
Grothendieck conjecture. I am not exactly sure, in fact. I think it's, I think they are developing rather independently.
When you quoted the Poincaré lemma, you didn't mention Poincaré. Does that mean that you doubt that he gave a proof?
I discussed with several people. So I first started reading the Dieudonné chapter on Poincaré work, which is a disaster because he says that Poincaré knew and did not really understand. For him, Poincaré even didn't know exactly what is a closed differential form. So that was a very bad start. And then I discussed with Catherine Goldstein, and she was not sure he proved that, exactly that statement. For her, he just stated the fact that D composed with D is zero, but did not prove the local exactness. But then Etienne, he gave me a few pages from Poincaré, and I could see that he knew much more than those people say. So personally, I am not working in history, and I do not have a personal belief, but I think that Poincaré knew a lot. Maybe he didn't pay attention to write things very in the way that we would need now, or in that form, but maybe.
He knew very well the exterior product because he writes determinants, for example,
of
the
course,
exterior
of
products
course,
of the symplectic
yeah,
form,
yeah,
and
yeah.
Things like that. So, other questions? No? So, thank you very much.